while since we did this.
Indeed, it's been a while since the last video, but thankfully I am back again. And when I was thinking about the first game to cover upon my return, the clear choice was the finals, given that I had already planned to cover this game due to the high demand from you all. Now, this game is developed by Embark Studios, founded by former DICE employees and developers who worked on old Battlefield games. And the influence of this background is evident in the finals, particularly from a technological standpoint, because much like the old Battlefield games, the finals places a strong emphasis on physics-based gameplay, featuring real-time destruction physics and even a fire propagation system, which are elements we really don't see anymore in modern video games. And when it comes to the engine, the game is built using Unreal Engine 5, and the graphics menu is pretty much identical to many other UE5 games. So today, and as usual, we will go through all these graphics settings and examine the performance and visual impact of each one. So let's jump right into it. Let's start by taking a look at image quality. And here for upscaling we have DLSS, FSR and XeSS. And if we compare these three options, we can see that DLSS produces the cleanest image, while FSR2 exhibits more shimmering compared to DLSS and XeSS. On the other hand, XeSS handles aliasing better than FSR2, but it looks softer and struggles when it comes to screen space reflections, as you can see here. For native resolution, we have TAAU with a resolution scale slider and DLAA, and as expected, DLAA offers a superior image quality compared to TAAU, albeit at a performance cost of around 6%. So overall, for image quality, Embark Studios should introduce Unreal Engine 5 CSR as an option for non-RTX GPUs owners, because the image quality with XeSS and FSR does not look good, especially at a low resolution. Now, despite using Unreal Engine 5, the finals doesn't leverage any UE5 features like Lumen, Nanite or Virtual Shadow Maps. Instead, for global illumination, Embark Studios is using RTX Global Illumination or RTX GI, which is a probe-based system that employs hardware ray tracing to simulate diffused indirect lighting. And here in the graphics menu, we have a setting that controls RTX GI. The static option turns it off completely, while the dynamic option turns it on with four quality options, ranging from low to epic. So what do these options do exactly? Well, based on my observations, these options do not affect the quality of the RTX GI. Instead, they change the rate at which the light probes update. Like here, you can see how with low, the lighting updates much slower compared to the options from medium to epic. And on the performance side, because of its probe-based nature, RTX GI is much cheaper compared to something like Lumen. Here we can see that going from static to even epic costs around 5%. However, when CPU bound like here, we can see that the performance gap between static and epic is slightly larger. So here, if you can use RTX GI, I highly recommend keeping it enabled with at least dynamic medium, because this will help you have maximum visibility during indoor combat scenarios. Next, we have view distance. This one controls the level of detail and draw distance of some objects, as you can see here. And low has some noticeable pop-in close to the camera, even when compared to medium. And on the performance side, going from low to epic costs around 2%. And I have also tried comparing low with epic in live matches like here, and as you can see, the performance difference is negligible. So here I recommend keeping this one at epic. Moving on to anti-aliasing, this one affects the quality of the game's TAA. Like here, you can see that epic looks a little bit more stable compared to low, and performance-wise, going from low to even epic shows negligible impact. So here, if you are using TAAU, I recommend keeping this one at epic. Moving on to shadows, and here using low can disable shadows completely in many scenes of the game, like here for example. And on the performance side, at this scene where low does not disable the shadows, we can see that going from low to medium costs around 3%, to high 7%, and to epic 12%. And if we switch back to the previous scene, we can see almost the same results. The only difference is that epic shadows are more demanding here, with around 16%. so here I recommend keeping shadows at medium. Next we have post-processing. This one adjusts some post-processing effects such as ambient occlusion, like here where we can see that low post-processing disables AO completely. Additionally, the intensity of the bloom effect is noticeably higher when using high compared to low or medium, and performance-wise going from low to medium costs around 5%, and to high and epic 7%. So here, given that ambient occlusion plays a huge role in any game's visual presentation, I recommend keeping post-processing at medium. Texture is next, and this one controls the quality of some textures like here. And surprisingly, the finals doesn't use a lot of VRAM, and I think the reason behind this is that Embark Studios are taking advantage of Unreal Engine 5's virtual texturing. And as you can see here, even at native 1440p with epic textures, we can see that the allocated VRAM is slightly above 5GB, while the used VRAM is below 4GB. Moving on to effects, and this one controls many visual aspects at the same time. First, we have the quality of screen space reflections, like here, where we can see that low disables SSR. Medium and high look almost identical with a perfect mirror-like reflections, unlike epic, which shows the accurate level of roughness in these reflections. This setting can also affect the quality of the game's lighting in some areas. Like here, we can see that the lighting from medium to epic looks more accurate and casts shadows alike low. Additionally, this stitching can impact the quality of certain visual effects, like the rain here, where we can see that both high and epic increase the density of the rain effect. And performance wise, this is by far the most demanding stitching in this game, because at this scene here, going from low to medium and high costs around 18%, and to epic 30%. So here, if you have enough performance to spare, I recommend medium just to keep SSR enabled. Foliage is next, and this one, as expected, adjusts the density of foliage, but the stitching only shows a difference in some areas. For example, here in the practice range, we can see that there is no visual disparity between the options. However, in another scene from a live map, we can see a visual difference, and here going from low to epic costs around 4%. So here I recommend keeping foliage at epic. And last but definitely not least, we have global illumination. And according to the graphics menu, this setting should control the resolution of screen space global illumination. So it seems like the game is using screen space GI in conjunction with RTX GI or baked lighting, depending on which one is enabled. And we can notice the effect of this setting and where screen space GI is applied if we take a look at this example, where we can see that this destructed surface looks less detailed when using lower options. And performance wise, going from low to medium costs around 4%, to high 6%, and to epic 9%. So here, given that it's hard to notice the visual impact of this stitching during typical gameplay, I recommend saving the performance and using low global illumination. And with all that being said, these are my recommended stitchings for the finals. Let's now compare the performance of the optimized settings and the epic preset. And here at the practice range, we can see that the optimized settings on average improve performance by around 52%. And here during a live match where it's really hard to capture identical side-by-side footage, we can see that the performance difference is almost identical compared to the practice range, hovering around a 50% improvement when moving from epic preset to optimized settings. And with that, we reach the conclusion of this video. Thank you so much for watching and for your time. If you enjoyed the video, leave a like, and if not, leave a dislike. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell for future videos. And hopefully, I'll see you all in the next video, which will most likely be about Helldivers 2. So stay tuned for that.